Hello, everyone. Can you please confirm that you can hear me? Everything is correct? Yep, perfect. It's the first time that I'm doing this kind of streaming thing. Not just talks, just a streaming thing. So expect some like noob stuff in the next hour. Okay, and let's start with this talk. Should I start, Hamza? Just to wait for the confirmation. Well, I guess if everyone can hear me, and that I think that I can start. I will try to read the comments during this one hour talk, but if something were wrong is happening, like you cannot hear me or something from the internet, just tell me and we will try to solve it. But yeah, let's start with it. So, okay, and this talk is about APIs, as you can see in the title. The idea of this talk is explain a bit the concept of an API, why is helpful, and apart from that, start and learning how to build one API. As I will explain, API is a very generic concept. I always like to describe this as a black box. So you can implement an API in every language you want almost. You can use Python, you can use Go, you can use JavaScript, whatever. I mean, you can use almost everything. Although, since this is just a 1 hour talk, we are gonna focus in Python, specifically with Flask, and also using OpenAPI, which is a different concept that I will explain. With that being said, I'm Albert, and I studied computer science and software engineering in UPC. And I'm currently now working in a startup in Barcelona called ResV.ai, which their product is an API. It's full API. And for 2 years now, I always, every day, working with API. So I kind of become to an API lover, especially for the concept, all the stuff. So yeah, I love all this concept. So let's start with this. Let me change to this one. Okay. With that, so let me focus this. Okay. So we are going to start and explain a bit the concept. So just to mention, this talk is the first of a trilogy of talks. I mean, this is a talk about APIs. The next one that we'll do, my colleague David, will be about React and frontend. And the last one with Ala will be about infrastructure, Docker, and more stuff. So expect that all the code and all that we'll want to explain will be in this GitHub repo. You already know what's GitHub, thanks to Martin's talk. So you can check it out. All the code that we are gonna explain and guide is here. So feel free to save this GitHub repo somewhere that could be useful in the future for you. With that being said, let's gonna start with this talk, which is the API model. Okay, there's a lot of files here. We are gonna explain it. But before, let's talk about what's an API, the concept, okay? So as it's been said here in this small README, the idea in API, the acronym is Application Programming Interfaces, but it's very common in the industry because at the end, what an API gives you is, you can say like data. Okay, I'm gonna call to this API, I'm gonna return something. With some input, I'm gonna get some output. And a lot of applications, front-end and web apps, and Android applications, whatever, needs APIs. And as I said, it's a black box, so you can implement those APIs in every language you want, but we're gonna do with Python. So it's been said here, is a black box where you given an input, you're gonna have some output. But there's rules with this API. You can at least, there's different types of APIs. The one that we are gonna explain and reason why is because it's the most famous type of APIs, which is the RESTful APIs. You're gonna understand what's a RESTful API, but the pattern of the rules of these RESTful APIs is given the input, and given the output that you're going to get, you have to specify a method. A method is the type of function of or thing that you want to do with API. There's a lot, but the more common types and the ones that we're going to apply for this and talk is get, put, post, and delete. It's more or less self-explainable, but the idea of get is retrieving data. Put is to edit or modify data. Post is to create a new entity or a new resource in the API. And then delete, as has been said, is delete or remove an entity or a resource. Okay, we are going to try to, when we later build this small API, to apply some pattern, design patterns, because at the end, an API is something that a lot of people will use. So you should follow a pattern, and there's like a standard, a pattern for that. So the idea, let's imagine, as it's been set in here, we have an API about companies, and those companies have employees. And we want to create new endpoints. Endpoints, as you've been said in the name, it's the point to entry to the API. So we can create endpoints, like for example, add new employee, update employee, delete employee, and looks correct, to be honest. But if we want to follow all these patterns, we cannot use verbs or actions in the name of the endpoints. We should use always nouns. Because at the end, when you are hitting the API, you want to get, post, and put, or delete some resource. And you have to specify that resource in the endpoint name. So an example for this use case should be, for example, method get with the path companies should get the list of all companies. The same with slash companies slash 34. What's 34? It's the identifier of the company, in this case, that you want to get. Because you can get all the companies with the slash companies or just one company with the slash companies slash 34. If you want to delete that company, you just apply a different method, not get, with the slash companies slash 34. There's other patterns that, especially this one that I'm going to explain, is the one that we're using when we are going to explain the build part of the API, which is slash companies and this symbol, which is the, I don't know how to explain in English, but yeah, this symbol is for saying to the API that, okay, from here to the end is the parameters, the input that I'm going to send to the API. In this case, it's, okay, the ID is 34. This case, the companies underscore 34 and the companies ID, both are okay, but from my opinion, just this is a point of view, I prefer the second one. So we are going to use the second one. Okay, this is the endpoint. This is the point that you should use for hit the API. Let's describe how to specify the input. So there's three types of input. The first one are the headers. As been said here, headers is usually being used for security parameters or for configuring requests of the API. But for this use case, we are not going to use it, but it's cool to know. Query parameters is exactly as the example that I just mentioned, which is in the endpoint, like ID equals 34. You can specify multiple query parameters and all appending with the Y character. And then in this case is okay, with this example, I'm going to get all the students from the university UPC and the faculty FIP. And in this case, I want to delete the subjects with the code ICSI. That's more or less the pattern from the input they want to use. Okay, this for the almost all the methods, you can use this in all methods, but you should not use query parameters in post methods. Okay, so in the post methods, how do I specify the input? Okay, in this case, you should use request body. Request body, it's something that it's not showable in the query. That's why it's request body. It's like a body inside the request, which there's a lot of different request bodies. You can like check this. There's JSONs, XML, .txt. There's a lot, but the most common and the one that we are going to use is JSON. And you should specify this as application JSON. Okay, in this case, and we're going to check what the JSON is, but the idea is to specify all the parameters in this JSON part. For example, for the post that we are going to see examples, the idea of a post is to create a resource as we said. So what you should specify in the request body of the post is all the information, all the parameters that the new resource should have. For example, if we're talking about students, you should specify, for example, the name, the last name, all the parameters that the API documentation specifies you, and you should follow that documentation. This is the input. So if we follow all the input requirements that the API has, we should have a successful output. In the same way that we have different request bodies, we can have different different output formats. But in most of the cases, and the RESTful APIs uses JSON as an output format. What's a JSON? As you can see here, it's called a dictionary, or it's a dictionary where every entity has a key and a value. And here we can say, like, we have a first key, which is widget, and inside widget we have three parameters. This value, which is called, is the value from the widget. And inside here we have three keys, which is debug, window, and image. Debug is just has a value on as a string. Window has another dictionary with three more and four more keys. And image, the same with five more keys. The value could be a string, could be a dictionary, as we said, could be an integer, could be a list, could be whatever a primary type is, okay? So our API that we're gonna build will have the JSON format as an output. Okay, more things. For the output, when you are building an API, you always should specify two things. One is the output itself, JSON format, XML format, whatever. And the other thing is the HTTP response status codes. This is for telling to the client, when you say client, I mean the user that will receive the response from the API, should identify if the response is correct, if everything should if everything went well. So the status code is specifying, as it's been said in the name, the status of the response. There are a lot of status codes. I mean, I would say more than 100 status codes, but we are going to focus in the top 10, which is the one that is more common when you are using APIs or when you are building APIs. The first one is the 200, which is the most common. It's like, everything went well, you can go ahead, everything is happy. The 201 is for, it's also a successful code. Actually, all the codes that starts with a 200, like 200, 201, 202, all those ones, are successful codes. So 201 is a successful code that specifies that the entity has been created successfully or has been modified successfully. 204 is especially useful for deletes, because if everything went well with a delete, you should not get any content, because at the end you delete the resource. So you should return a 204 as a status code for this use case, for the delete use case. More things. When the status code starts with a 400, these are errors. So the client should handle those errors and those status codes as an errors. So bad request, as you've been saying here, is general error for when fulfilling requests would cause an invalid state. Domain validation errors, missing data. This is the case when you are, for example, you required a query parameter called ID, and you are not sending that ID. This is an error from the user. So you should, as an API, specify, okay, guy or girl, you miss the ID query parameter and I did that to process your request. So you should return that 400 error. More things, 401 unauthorized error. We are not gonna see this because our API is open, there's no authentication, but if your API has authentication, you should return a 401 if it's a request unauthorized. More things, 403 is forbidden, means that you cannot access to that endpoint because any reason. 404 is a typical that we always see, which is not found. 405 is method not allowed, which means that, okay, the endpoint that you hit exists, is something that it's in the API, but you are not you are using a method that is not allowed. For example, if the slash user 12345 is forgetting the users but has not implemented the delete, just for saying, if you are specifying the delete, you should return a 405 method not allowed. Conflict is something more uncommon, but whenever a resource conflict would be caused by fulfilling the request, duplicate entries such as trying to create two customers with the same information. So if you have some precondition stuff, like for example, a user cannot have the same username, which makes sense. So if I as an Albert, I create a user with the Albert username, and then another person wants to create another user with different information, but the username is the same, you should return as a conflict. And the last one, which is the one that we do not want to return, which is the 500, which is something bad happened, but we don't know what happened. Okay, this is for the status code. Apart from that, I always, when I do talks or workshops about APIs, I always recommend this website. It's very useful if you want to check the status codes. For example, if I open this new tab and get http.cat, and okay, I want to know what's the 400 error. If I type, okay, not found. Thanks. So just a really good website just for you for the future. Okay, that's for the theory. Let's go to the code. And now it's time for the specifying the setup. So just to mention, as I said, this API is built in Python, specifically with Python 3.7. But as I said, you can implement it whatever you want. With that being said, let's go to the code. Let me change this. Okay, perfect. So we are going to focus just in the API model as we are doing. There's a lot of files, so we are going to check all the files and understand why those files are important. So since this is a Python application, and Python, as most of libraries, most of programming languages, uses external libraries, you should specify all the external libraries in a file called requirements.txt. If we check this file, we see here 8 different external libraries. We are going to explain deeply later, but the first one, which is Connexion. And Connexion is something really cool, and especially I'm going to emphasize about Connexion during this talk, which is a useful library, open source library, actually implemented by Zalando, which is connecting the Flask, which Flask is the most common web framework in Python, and OpenAPI, where OpenAPI is a specification. It's a style for documenting, specifying APIs. Okay, so this connection, what it's doing, and you are gonna see why it's so cool, you are connecting the Flask application and the OpenAPI specification. Okay, Flask, you already know what it is because I already explained. UWSGI, what a name, I know. It's really cool for deploying stuff, but I'm not gonna go very deeply with this because my colleague Ala he's gonna explain deeply about this. But it's for deploying APIs. Request is for doing requests through the internet and through HTTP protocols. SQLAlchemy is really useful because in this API we're using a Postgres database, so SQLAlchemy is for managing all the SQL stuff without bothering you a lot with those problems. So it's really comfortable. And this is something like related to the SQLAlchemy, which is needed for compiling and for using SQL databases. Something that I always do for my projects, especially with the Python projects, is also have to requirements.log. This is something very Pythonic. So you have the requirements.txt, which is the libraries itself, and requirements.log, if you when you're installing the libraries, you specify the freeze command, what it's doing, as the freeze said, is like it's to freeze all the libraries in the versions that we have. And then here we have the connection with that version, Flask with that version, and all the site, I don't know how to say it, actually I don't know the name, but it's like other libraries that these libraries is using also with the needed versions. So this is very useful because if you are sharing this project with other people and like playing with this project with more people and collaborating, you should use always the same library version because it will crash. I mean, that's for sure. So I always recommend and freeze all the requirements to another file at requirements.log and have these frozen requirements here. With that being said, we are going through the code. So first step, we are going to check the OpenAPI specification. What's an OpenAPI specification? Okay. Here, it's a YAML file. I don't know if you had experience before with a YAML file, but at the end, it's a format, just a format. But it just is very common in a lot of libraries. For example, OpenAPI is using YAML as a format. But this format, this style, is for specifying and how your API should look and with what is the rules that you should use for your API. When I mean rules, I mean what's the input, how the output should look like, and where are the endpoints, what's the name of the endpoints, all that stuff. So in this case, our API, I didn't mention that, it's an API about contacts. It's like an agenda. So you have contacts, then, as we said, we can have the get, the put, the post, and the delete. We can get contacts, we can add contacts, we can modify contacts, and we can delete contacts. So in this case, in this OpenAPI specification, we have the info, which is just info, information about your API. The servers, this is for specifying if you have where your API will be deployed. In the local host as a development, or as a production level, you can check this URL if you want. This is the same API that we are going to use, but in a server that we have there. Tags, this is for tagging all your just metadata of your API. And then important information is the paths. These are the endpoints that the API has. So for example, we have the slash contacts, where this slash contacts has the method get, the method post, the method put, and last one, method delete. As you almost know, so this is for retrieving the contacts, so you can specify some information, like the summary, description. Operation ID, we are gonna get into that in a sec. And the parameters, this is the input. If you're specifying parameters as is query parameters. So in this case, there's a query parameter called contact ID, which is not required because we want to have the availability with the same endpoint to return just one contact or return all the contacts. So it's not required. So if you do not specify the contact ID, you should return all the contacts. And then the responses, you specify here the status code. So we said that 200 is the good one. And here you specify in this schema how the API responds. Where is this schema? If you go down, 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 down to the specification, here we have the API response. Where the API response is an object that has the following properties. The property error, which you can specify the type and the description, message, and response. Where the response could be and four different responses, depends on the method that you are using. If you're using the get, which is the one that we want to know now, you're gonna go up, 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 and then API response get, where we have the contact data and the contact ID. What's the contact ID? It's just the ID of your contact. And the contact data is all the information that you will get when you are hitting this endpoint. You get the name, the last name, image URL, address, phone number, an email. Okay, that's perfect. So let's go back. So here is for specifying the input and the output of the get. For the post, we have the same. So we have the description summary, but in this case, as I said before, for post, you should not use query parameters. You should always use request body. And here we specify the request body that you want to use, which is required. The content is application JSON, as I said, that we are going to use the most common response type format. And this schema is like the contact data, the same as you will get if you are if you want to get or retrieve the contacts. So you have the name, last name. You should specify all the information. And in this case, the status code that we are gonna return is the 201 because you are creating an entity. For the put, is very, very similar. Here we have two things, query parameters and request body. The request body is more is the same as the post because you want to edit all the all the parameters or just one, but you have to have the availability to change all the parameters. And the parameters with the contact ID, because you should specify. That's why this is required true, because you need the contact ID and then the request body. So this is the contact that I want to modify. And with the request body, these are the properties, the parameters, the data that I want to change from my contact. And the last one, here we don't have a request body. We just have the contact ID, which is required in this case. And here, we have the so we have the identifier of the contact that we want to delete. And as I said before, if this is correct, we should return a 204, which is contact deleted, and is the status code related to this functionality. This for the OpenAPI specification. I mean, it could look a bit complex, but OpenAPI specification is a huge open source project, and there's a lot of documentation, a lot of community, and there's, if you have more questions, you can ask later in the QA session or Google OpenAPI. Last thing is to check the operation ID parameter that all the endpoints has. What's that? If you take a look, it's source API contacts again. This looks like a path to a function, to an operation. So if we check here the process schema that we have the source, we have the API, and then contacts. Where contacts, here we have the magic. Here we have how these endpoints should return or should operate when you are calling the API. So in this case, where we have source API contacts get, we are going to the contacts to this function. The same with the post, same with put, and same with delete. And here is the Python code that applies and works all the API. So we are gonna check how this is working. Let me check what time is it for managing. Okay, everything's good. Let me drink some water. Remember, drink water every time. 2 liters per day, at least. With that being said, so let's start from the get. This is for retrieving contacts, just all contacts or just one contact if we are specifying the contact ID. The magic here, and this is why I loved Connexion, because Connexion is just, okay, specifying my Flask app and then my OpenAPI specification, we are the one that we checked, then merge all this. So that's why in this file, in the agenda file, here we have how this Connexion app, this Flask and OpenAPI app is starting. So we are creating the Flask app using the Connexion library with the name and then specifying where the OpenAPI folder is. That's why the OpenAPI folder is here and the agenda file is here. Here we are getting the Flask app, applying some configurations. You don't have to especially to look deeply into that, but just to know. And then the Connexion app should add this OpenAPI specification with a title if you want, it's not needed, but always cool to have. With that, you should specify the course stuff. Course is a very difficult thing, I think, to explain, but to go ahead and not spend a lot of time here, just set this flag for getting your API work. So in this connection app, with these 5 lines or 4 lines, it's working, it's already working. So here we have endpoints, but we are gonna take a look into that later. But with this just 5 lines, everything is working. So now going back to the endpoint file, here we have the gets. So since in the OpenAPI specification, we specify that we have a contact ID parameter, which is not required, here we can specify as a parameter in our function that we have a contact ID, but it's not required. It's not required. So here we have two workflows. The one, okay, if contact ID is none, means that we want to return all the contacts. So that's why you should use this service that we are going to explain later with getAll, and then grab all these contact list and return as a response. Here we're specifying the same format that we specified in the OpenAPI specification, where we have error and the response, where inside the response we have the response. And also, apart from that, we're specifying as well the status code. So in this case, everything went well, so we should return the 200. But if the contact ID is not none, we should specify the contact that we want to get. And if the contact is correct, we should return this contact with 200. And if the contact doesn't exist, we should return error true with the message contact not found. Always, as I always recommend, that all your endpoints, all your code actually in general, you should wrap all this in a try except or whatever. I mean, every programming language has the same stuff, which at the end, okay, run this code, and if something bad happened, just raise an exception and return to the client that something bad happened. Okay, this is for getting. This is for the post. So here it's a bit different because we don't have query parameters as you see here, but we have the request body as we specified in the OpenAPI specification. So here we get the request JSON, and we get all the parameters that we need. We need the name, the last name, image URL, address, phone number, and email. We have here all the parameters, and this is a Python function for checking if all these values are not known, because at the end we need all this, all the parameters are required. So if any of these parameters is not specified, means that this value, for example, is none, we should return an error to the client that's saying, okay, this is not our fault, it's your fault. You are not specifying all the parameters that I need. If everything went well, we can go ahead and then add, using our service, this new contact with all the parameters that we get from the request body. Then, given the contact ID, we always return and this contact ID to the client that, okay, with the 201 status code, everything went well, is created, here you have the contact ID the contact ID from the contact that you are just created. And if everything went wrong, you should specify error true and the contact could not be created. And the same with exception. For the boot, this is very, very, very similar. If you see, we same stuff, we get all the parameters, but here we don't specify the if, because at the end, it's not needed to specify all the information. If you want to just change the name, it's fine. So we don't have the if condition that we have before in the post. But here we are using the contact service as well, but with the edit function, using the contact ID that we get from the query parameter. Here, if we come back to the OpenAPI and we go to the put, here we specify the required is true. So it's a must to have this parameter. With that being said, we edit the contact edited. If it's true, perfect, just modify true. If not, modify false. And with the delete, same stuff. We have the required contact ID parameter. And with that, we use the contact service, delete the contact, and then return the response to the client, if it's deleted or not. With that being said, here we have the endpoints. So, okay, before going to the service and understand how this is working, we are going to check the DB. As I said before, here we are using SQLAlchemy, which is a very, very, very cool library for Python for managing all the SQL databases. So this is very simple. The idea is we build this function for connecting to the database. So we're specifying all the needed information, the user, the password, the database name, the host, where the database is located, and the port. And then getting all the information, we are creating an engine for getting into the database and return this. And in and oh sorry, let me bring some water. I said it's important. And with that, given the engine and the meta, we are gonna create the DB session. With this is the entry point to the database. Okay, with that being said, we are going now to the model. Model here we specify how our contact looks like. This is like a screenshot of the database, but in a Python way. So especially Ala will explain more about the Postgres stuff, but here we have just one database, just one table, which is contact, and has all this information. The ID, name, last name, image URL, address, phone number, an email. And here is specifying how these properties are. So this is the an integer with the primary key, all the columns with all our strings. It's just specifying how the contact table is in SQL and mapping that SQL table to a Python object with where this Python class is called contact. And last step, if we're going to service, here we have the service contact, where it's a pattern in software called service pattern. Yeah, the name is very cool. So the idea is to all the functions that interacts with the database should be there. And if the interaction is about contacts, you should specify all the interaction here. So here we have this and the stuff that we were using in the endpoints file, where we have the get all and get contact. And here is very simple. It's very like self-explanatory in my opinion. So we have the DB session that we import from the file that I just mentioned. We query with all the contacts, ordering by contact ID. It's not a must ordering by contact ID, but I always use it. And we want to return all. And if we get something, serialize all these contacts and return to the one using this function. Same stuff by contact ID. We have the same DB session query, but here we are filtering by something. What's the something thing? It's the contact ID we get from the parameter. And if we get some contact, we should serialize. If not, return none, because it means that that contact does not exist and we should return some error or some stuff. Add is more or less the same. So we have the contact object, that is the Python object that I just mentioned. And with all the parameters in the function, we specify all the information. With that contact created, we specify, we add that contact in the database, and we commit. When we are saying commit, okay, it's like, okay, the contact that I'm just adding, I want to confirm that I want to add this contact. So we have to say to the database that to commit this contact. With that, now this contact has an ID that is being auto-generated, and with that contact ID, we return this contact ID because it's needed for the endpoint to be returned. Edit is kind of the same, but here we are getting the contact because at the end we want to edit an existing contact, so we have to get this contact. And if exists, edit, if not, return false, because means that this is this edit could not be handled because the contact doesn't exist. So with that contact, we specify the name, the last name, if this name is not known. Because if we are, and since all these parameters are optional, because if you, maybe you only want to change the name. So if you want to edit just the name, then change this contact name to the name that I just get from the function. If not, just set the same, because at the end I don't want to modify it. If it's the case, commit as well. We have to say to the database that this is the status that we want to confirm, to commit to the database, and return true. And the delete, same stuff. We get the contact because we have to delete that contact. And then once that contact is successfully get it, we are gonna delete it using the DB session. And once that's done, commit as well and return true to the to the endpoint. With that being said, I think that the code is more or less explained. So with that, let's test very quickly this API. Let me check the time that we're having. Nice. Okay, let me change this. Okay, this. So now you should see, instead of PyCharm I didn't mention, it's an IV, and no, I don't know how to say, it's a program for specified for Python. You can use whatever you want, but I like PyCharm. And Postman, this is Postman. If you are new with APIs building or knowing the concept of APIs, I 100% recommend to install this program. It's very, 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 very useful and has a lot of features that we are not going to talk about it, just we are going to have in the basic overview. But it's very useful for calling APIs and interact with APIs. So we are going to focus on this. So here we have our API deployed in the local host. In this case, we have the get method, as you can see here. As you see, we have a lot of methods, but we are going to just focus on get. So get to this endpoint with API and contacts. If we do not specify the contact ID and we send the request, here we can get all the contacts that we want to get. But if we specify the contact ID 1, for example, and we click to send, here, as we saw before, we are only getting the contact number 1. What happens if we are specifying a contact ID that it doesn't exist? If we implemented well, the API should return an error like contact not found. That's very nice. So going back to the 1, now we are getting this. Perfect. With that being said, going out to the post. As we said, post is for creating resources, so this endpoint is useful for creating contacts. So in this case, we are going to create this contact with the name Carlota, all this information, all the parameters are needed. Means that if I'm deleting this line and sending, the API is like, okay, there are some required parameters missing, so this is fine. But if I specify all the parameters and return, boom. Error false, and the ID that we just create is the 13. If we copy this ID and we get back to the get and specify the 13 and click send, boom, here we have the new contact. If we want to edit this new that we just want to create it, this is the 13, go to body, and here I want to change the email. And just instead of that, let's say blah, 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 at blah.dep. If we send, we want to change this information, the email information from the contact ID 13. If we click to send, boom, modified true. And for confirming that, we are gonna get as well. And here we have the new email that we want to specify. And the last thing, if we want to delete and specify the contact that we just created, which is the 13, here there's no request body, just the contact ID, and click send. Boom, deleted, true. And again, if we check here, we should get the contact not found. So yeah, looks like our API is working with more or less what we explained. Now, let me show you something very cool. But for that, should I change here? Okay. Okay, so here is the explanation about the API, how it's working, how all the components are connected. And in like 5 minutes, we are going to have the QA session, so no worries for the questions. But here, using all the connection stuff that we saw, if we click to the API, if we check to the local host, port and then we specify this URL, which is API UI, is something that this is very normal. No worries, we should specify this. Sorry. Okay. This is something very, very, very cool, in my opinion. Is something that we didn't do anything about that. Is something that Connexion, that Zalando library that I mentioned, auto-generates for us. It's just, as you see, it's a UI, that's the name, of your API. This is generated by Connexion using the OpenAPI specification. This is thanks to OpenAPI, not thanks to Flask. So this is one of the reasons that you should use this. So here, you have all the specifications. You can actually test the API here as well. So this is very, very, very useful. And apart from that, there's another thing that I mentioned also in the code. Let's check this. So if we change back to the PyCharm and we get to the agenda, where is the like the main function of our project. Here we have a new root, and called docs, where we have some stuff here, but at the end we are getting an HTML file and appending the content of this file to a response. What this HTML file is, this one that we have in the templates folder. It's a very, 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 very simple HTML file, but this HTML file is using a library called ReDoc. This is another one extremely useful and tool, and this is also thanks to OpenAPI, because these are very common HTML file, very simple, but just focus on this. Here we are specifying a URL with a OpenAPI YAML specification. What happens if we have to do that? If we're going back to Chrome, and here instead of UI, we specify the docs. Here we have a very beautiful, in my opinion, API for your use. At the end, an API is something very useful for, an API, you are building an API for getting used. I mean, you are using an API for someone to hit the API and use the API. So if you are using the API just for you, it's not very well. So at the end is to, use and build an API for getting used. So with that, I think that I more or less explain all here. Okay. I don't know if I lost the connection because something bad happened here, but whatever. Let's think that this not happened. So with that being said, I think that we explained all. I for sure and miss something, though that's why the QA session is useful. So let's change now to the QA session. So feel free now to ask some questions that I'm for sure I missed. Any question that you have, you should do it now. If not, no worries, I will be around. When I say around, I mean Discord all the day. So if your project has an API or something like that, or using Python itself or OpenAPI, no worries, and just ping me on Discord and I will answer your question. So do you think I can apply this to El Raco API? For sure. So at the end, in this case, El Raco API is an API that is already built. So you can use Postman for interacting with this API, getting how the response are, testing the API at the end. But what you can do is, if you want to do something on top of this API, what you can do is build another API in the same way that we explained, and then call this Raco API inside your API, for sure. I mean, at the end, as I said, an API is a black box, where the black box means any programming language that you want, any stuff that you want, and inside that black box could happen whatever you want. That's why I think I love APIs and all that concept. Joel, me ayudarás, sure. I mean, as I said, I'll be around all the day, so I can for sure help you in everything you need about APIs. And so, yeah, we have some more time for questions, if you have. If not, no worries. Alternative of cats, yeah, that's very true. Is I already knew that website, but to be honest, I prefer the http.cat. I don't know. I love more dogs than cats, but not what. Hi, how does OpenAPI handle consumer-driven contracts for involving APIs? Oh, wow, these are very deep questions about APIs. To be honest, I know what a consumer-driven contract is. It's something that the client or the consumer is specifying to the API in the way that how the API should look like. But for being honest, I never used consumer-driven contracts at all, and specifically in OpenAPI, Connexion, Python, all that stuff, neither. So sorry, but I cannot help you in that. I can Google it and try to search for an answer if you are still interested, and later, and we can talk through Discord and see what your thoughts. But sorry, but I didn't have enough experience with consumer-driven contracts for having a clear answer about that. Thank you for all the questions. Someone more? No worries. Thank you to you for listening. So let's wait just 1 minute more, just for see if anyone has more questions. But if not, as I said, just ping me in Discord, or if you have more questions, search start your this repo, especially for APIs, React, which is the next talk, or Docker, which is the next talk. But I think that this could be useful as a pattern or a structure to follow for your projects. Either way, it's an API, either way it's a React, or either way you're using Docker, because at the end, both three, and David, Alain, and myself, we try to structure all this code and at the end these three talks in order to have this as a pattern, as a template for your future project. Actually, to be honest, for the next hackathons that I'm going to attend, I'm for sure going to use the code that I did for this talk, and yeah, that's for sure what I did. So, and yeah, and don't forget to join us at the Pinturillo game at 4 p.m. That's it, guys. So if you have any more questions, just Discord. Thanks a lot for hearing me. I guess that was helpful. I'm sorry for my English. I'm not native, as you can see. So thanks a lot, and yep, see you on Discord.